anti-Semitism took an ever stronger hold in Germany. Also moving into the same neighborhood of Amsterdam was the family of Anne Frank. Hannelore befriended the Frank girls, but was better friends with Anne's older sister, Margot. She apparently experienced Anne as a noisy chatterbox and a little shrimp. She was lively, but may have already been showing signs of her writing interest. So Hannelore is the one that Anne Frank refers to as Hansi in her diary she kept as her family went into hiding for 2 years to avoid being captured during the Nazi occupation of Holland. And she is among the last of the living friends of Anne Frank. Her perceptions of Anne have changed significantly as she has studied the diary Anne kept during those 2 years in hiding. And she brings to us this evening the larger story, born out of her direct experiences with Anne and the family, as well as her decades of scholarly work in relationship to the diary materials left behind. And as she speaks, she also honors the plea of those who died in that Holocaust. And I quote, "Be a witness for us. Tell the world. Make sure this outrage will never be repeated." So will you please join me in extending a warm OSU welcome to Laureen Nussbaum.
Thank you all for the warm welcome. I have a tendency to speak too fast. I also speak with an accent. So if you have trouble understanding me, please raise your hand right then and there. Don't sit and suffer and think, what for heaven's sake does this woman say? That's not worth your while. So please stop me. I am an old teacher and I'm accustomed to students raising their hand and asking impossible questions. So just ask, okay? Well, first of all, thanks to the committee here in Corvallis, in particular to Paul Kopperman for inviting me. I was mighty surprised because I have been really retired for the last 2 years and haven't done any speaking. Before I did ever so often, but I haven't done really any speaking for 2 years. So I came really out of retirement to do this. And I'm delighted to be here on a beautiful spring day, and I'm impressed that so many people came on a beautiful spring day. With all of this, in the introduction and in the paper, and I don't know where people got it from, I am not in Anne's diary. I mean, I don't mind for you to reread it again, but you won't find me. I'm not in her diary. Because we were really not close friends. The families knew each other. The Frank family came from Frankfurt to Amsterdam at the end of 1933. My family came from Frankfurt to Amsterdam in 1936. And since the parents, the Frank parents, and my parents, the Kleins, knew each other, I'm sure that Mr. Frank was very helpful to my father to set up business in Amsterdam. And the two families saw each other at irregular intervals, typically the way we visited in Holland for a cup of tea and a cookie after dinner. So either the parents would come, or if they came on a Saturday afternoon, or if we visited on a Saturday afternoon, it was for tea and cookies, never for meals. And we never had sleepover parties and these fun things that people have here. We didn't have that. It was not part of our upbringing. Otto Frank and my father were, is the sound good? It sounds very shrill here. Is it okay? Okay, good. Otto Frank and my father were instrumental in founding in Amsterdam a liberal Jewish synagogue, typically in the Netherlands, particularly in the city of Amsterdam. People were either religious and then they would belong to an Orthodox synagogue, or they were nothing. I remember when we came to Amsterdam, the population was about 800,000, and of the 800,000, 30% were Roman Catholic, 30% were Protestant, 30% were nothing, and 10% were Jews. Wonderful mixture. And everybody seemed to get along quite well with everybody else. People stuck to their own groups to a certain extent with regard to the newspapers they read, the radio programs they listened to, sometimes the schools they sent their children to, but there was a tolerance of each other that was admirably kept through the years, really. Excuse me, I run dry very fast. This is water. So, maybe if we start with a picture. Let me see whether I can make the machine work. This is my second PowerPoint presentation, and yeah, there's Anne. Okay. This is a picture taken of Anne at school in 1941. Pictures were taken every year, and she sits with her arms crossed. And this is a picture of me, taken the same year, also with the arms crossed. It was a typical school picture. So Anne would have been 12, and I would have been 14 when the picture was taken. Now we go back in history. Anne and Margot on the lap of their father, Otto. We all admired Otto Frank. He was an ideal daddy, as comes out very strongly in the diary. He did something that my family just was amazed at. He, on Sunday mornings, he would prepare breakfast and bring it to his wife's bedside. That's something my daddy would never have done. We just really admired him for this kind of kindness. And he was also particularly interested in his girls' upbringing. He was more of an active father than was usual in our circles. In our circles, the daddies brought in the wives all the food, and the mothers took care of the children in the kitchen and so on. But Otto Frank was an exception, really. So here he is with Margot and Anne at a very young age for the girls. And here's the mother, Edith, with Margot and Anne also in Frankfurt still. The picture is a little dark here. Can you see it? There's nothing much I can do about it, but it's darker than I thought it should be. All right. Well, here's Anne in 1935. She's already in Holland. Very sweet girl, very lovely face. And here, that's one of my favorite pictures, because here she is at her desk, still at home, not in hiding, writing. And writing for Anne was something that was very, very important. I didn't go to school with her. She was 2 years younger. But I've talked to two of her classmates, and both of them said that Anne was constantly writing something. And it seems that it was something that was important to her and that nobody else was supposed to read because she always covered it up. But here she is sort of proudly, as far as I remember, sitting on a cushion so that she can reach the desk better writing. Writing, writing. Oh, I'm running ahead. No Peter's just yet, okay. All right, so life in Amsterdam, I don't know. Has everybody read the diary? Is there? Nobody would say, no, I haven't, I suppose. Anyway, Anne describes how gradually, first in Germany, that she did not describe because she was too young, but first in Germany, in my experience, we were marginalized. We couldn't go to public school anymore. We had to go to Jewish schools. We couldn't go to the theater. We couldn't go to the beach. Well, in Frankfurt, there was no beach, but not to the parks, not to the forest. We were totally cut out of anything that was recreational or cultural. So life became very, very narrowly focused. The year 1941-42 in Amsterdam, after we had already been marginalized, was the critical year, really. We were, again, not allowed to partake of anything cultural. In the fall of 1941, we were sent to Jewish schools. We couldn't go to public schools anymore. In contrast to my experience in Germany, where a girl with whom I had walked to school every day, first and second grade, wouldn't walk with me in third grade anymore because I had to go to a Jewish school, which was in the same building, by the way, and she had to go to the other part of the building, and she just wouldn't want to be near to me. I've never had any of these experiences in Holland, so that was certainly positive about Amsterdam. Anyway, so I'm now in 1941. In the fall of 1941, when we were totally excluded from anything cultural, we tried to keep our minds and brains alive by doing cultural things on our own. There was chamber music, there was play reading, there was poetry groups, and I had brought from Frankfurt a Jewish play from the Jewish school that we did when I was a third grader. And I thought, well, why shouldn't we entertain our parents and siblings by doing that play? Which was kind of risque because we had switched to Dutch so very, very fast that, for instance, for Anne, German was a foreign language. For my younger sister also, German was a foreign language. My older sister and I and Margot were old enough to still speak German quite well. So we put on that play in my parents' apartment. My parents were always very generous in having anything that needed to be done or celebrated could always be done at our house. So we had a wonderful, heavy, red velvet curtain between the dining room and the living room. It just looked like a stage. So the dining room was the stage and the living room was the auditorium. And we put on this play called The Princess with the Long Nose. And I am not entirely sure, but I'm 90% sure that Anne was the princess. She definitely was in the play. And I definitely was the stage director. That's what I know for sure. But I don't, anyway, she was in the play, and that's when I got to see her several times in the 2 weeks that led up to the performance. And she was a fast study, and we had a great time doing the play. Of course, the nose was not a real nose, but one that had to be put on, you know, as you turned around. And anyway, the princess was a nasty girl, very cheeky, very self-indulgent. And when she suddenly found herself with this long nose that came to her by magic cake that she ate, she all of a sudden became wise to the world that she was going to be a good girl, and if only she got rid of the nose, and then there comes some wonderful red wine from Israel, and her nose goes off, and she is all of a sudden a good girl and not a pest anymore. So that was the gist of the story. I mean, third grader, you know, so what can you expect? Anyway, we had a great time doing it. We did it twice during the Christmas Hanukkah season of 1941, and everybody was very happy that we had gone through the trouble, and it was a great success. So that's when I saw Anne quite frequently. Otherwise, I didn't see much of her. She was younger, and she and my younger sister did not go to religious education. My older sister and Margot and I bicycled together, so I got to know Margot much better. And if I have any regrets about Anne's diary, it is that maybe not enough justice is done to Margot, who was a wonderful girl. Very scholarly, very ladylike, which I admire because I was a tomboy. And just a very fine person, really. But now that we have gone through some parallels between the Frank family and my family, let's see that we do some pictures of my family. Here's Peter, by the way. Peter I know, too. He was, I said, a nincompoop, which is not very respectful. But, compared to Anne, he had nothing much to offer. He was a nice boy, beautiful blue eyes, but nothing. To be very intrigued with, let's put it this way. Okay, now we come to my family, just because of the parallel things. Anybody guess which one I am? Yes, that's me, the one with the curly hair. Okay, sadly, I'm the only one that's left over of the three sisters now. Both my sisters died recently. So this is the three of us still in Frankfurt. and also still in Frankfurt, that's just me. And here, this is much later. This is already in 1942 in Amsterdam. We didn't usually do the dishes on the balcony, but the camera that was used was not all that modern, and in order to get no flash, so we pretended we were doing dishes on the balcony, but that was not our usual way of doing dishes. So there we are, the three of us. But now I already ran ahead into the year 1942. I mentioned that we had to go to Jewish schools. I mentioned that we could not partake of any cultural or recreational things anymore. What I did not mention was that as of May of 1942, we had to wear the yellow star. And I think this is the next picture, yes. It's the yellow star. This is my ninth grade. I don't know whether you can see well enough, but you see the star on most of the people. The lady in front was a history teacher, bookkeeping next to her, French teacher who became a professor later on, very, very fine teacher. He survived. But of the kids, the 16 of us, four survived. The rest of them were all killed in concentration camps. And so were at least two, if not three, of the teachers. I'm not entirely sure. While I was in ninth grade and was in seventh grade, her first year of high school in Holland, I don't have a picture of her with a star, but she had to wear the star just like everybody else. And then, I mean, everybody Jewish, obviously. And then on July the 5th of 1942, here we are, this is the one I wanted to show. Margot was sunbathing on the flat roof in front of the attic rooms, and so was Anne, and the bell rang, and that's when the summons came that Margot had to report for labor service in Germany, July 5th, 1942. And the Franks took this as a signal, and they went into hiding the next day. And what happened in hiding, of course, all of you read in the diary. Anne first didn't know that the call was for Margot. She thought it was for her father, because Anne got very easily excited and panicky, and they kept it from her. But after a few hours, she found out what the true story was. And so the Franks went into hiding, and here's Anne on the same roof where Margot was sitting. And here's now the part of Amsterdam where the hiding place is. This green and blue up there, that's where the office and the warehouse and the hiding place were. The big tower in the middle is the Westertoren, which has a very wonderful sonorous bell, and Anne writes about it, how she loved the chimes of the Westertoren, very central in Amsterdam. Several of you must have been to the Anne Frank house, you can't, right? I'm sure some people did, yeah. And then you know the Westertoren too. So Anne was very fond of the Westertoren. All right. Well, I did not know, nor did my parents know, that the Franks were in hiding in Amsterdam. They had sort of concocted a story, and we became awfully good at concocting stories, that they had fled to Switzerland, which was not very probable, but possible. And to have it be possible was good enough for all of us to want to believe it. Mr. Frank had served as an officer in the German army in World War I. It was quite possible that he had some friends, non-Jews, who helped him. And so we hoped for the best, and that was it. And we didn't give the Franks another thought, because we were surrounded by people who had to either be deported, allow themselves to be deported, or had to go into hiding. When we came back to school in the fall of 1942, my then 10th grade class dwindled every day. let's say we started out with 15, I don't exactly know the number anymore. The next day we were 13, the next day we were 9. And we never asked whether so-and-so was in hiding or was deported. You just didn't ask questions. One of the reasons being that you didn't want to know what you didn't have to know, because you could always be apprehended and tortured and you could spill the beans. So it was just an unwritten law that you did not ask any questions about anybody, that you were not the first person to help. If it was your responsibility to take care of a person, then of course you knew, but otherwise you didn't know. That was the rule of the game. Well, I already said that the Frank family went into hiding the day after Margot got a call. Margot was one of 4,000 people, young people, ages 16 to 40, that got a call to report. The Franks did not report. My older sister also got a call to report for labor. Anne was too young, she was 13. I was too young, I was 15. But my sister, older sister, was older. And so she got a call. But my family had done something which I just alluded to earlier when I said we were very good at making up tales. My mother, who had a non-Jewish mother, made up a story that she was not really sired by my Jewish grandfather, but that my grandmother had had some hanky-panky with a non-Jewish man. It was all a big fat lie, but but they did it very, very well. And so because of that, my sister got a deferment. The way this game was played was that you got yourself a good Dutch lawyer, you wrote a petition in which you explained why you are claiming that you are not Jewish, or only half Jewish, or only quarter Jewish, or whatever your claim was. And that claim would go to an office in The Hague. The Hague, the capital of the Netherlands, had the headquarters of the German occupation. And there was a person by the name of Hans Kallmeier, I'll produce him in a moment, who had to adjudicate all cases where people claimed they were not as Jewish as their papers read. And so at the point that my sister got a call, our petition had not been approved and had not been disapproved either. It was pending. And that was enough at that moment to give my sister a deferment. And deferments were the name of the game. As long as you could a deferment, you were not deported just yet. Who were deferred besides people that had claims? Doctors were deferred, greengrocers who served Jewish clientele, nurses, teachers, as long as they were students. But you have to picture the situation in the Jewish school as the classes dwindled, every day less children. I remember that the chemistry teacher my sister and I had once came to me desperate and said to me, "Your sister isn't doing any homework anymore." I was good in chemistry, so I was, I guess, teacher's pet, or so, I don't know. Anyway, he talked to me about it. And I said, "No wonder she was the only student left in her class. Can you imagine in 11th grade to be the only student, nobody else? Everybody else was either deported or in hiding." So, of course, the teachers were trembling in their boots because they knew the moment all the children were gone, then their deferment would be annulled and they would go. So it's very hard to do your lessons, to do your algebra, to learn your French irregular verbs, and do all the things that you are supposed to be doing in school, knowing it's going to fall apart tomorrow. It was very, very tough times. All right, let's see what comes next. This is a little bit running ahead. I don't want to do that now. Okay, so the story of my family went on the following way. By January of 1943, the petition that my mother was not Jewish at all, which was a big fat lie, was approved, and not accidentally approved, but because the man, the German officer who was in charge of adjudicating these cases, really was not a Nazi. He was not a member of the Nazi party. He was a German, of course, but he was not a Nazi. And he used his office to give his stamp of approval to as many people as he could. And as best as we know, he gave the stamp of approval in 3,000 cases. And I take my family as an example. Other families were different. But in the case of my mother, the fact that her status was approved meant that the five of us, my two sisters and I, my mother, that makes four, and my father, who was now in a mixed marriage, we were all saved. So this man definitely saved more people than the famous Schindler, and far too few people know about him, but he was really a hero. Because to do this while pretending to be a faithful servant of Hitler, and yet to behind everybody's back to try to save as many people as you can, that's quite heroic, really. All right, I somehow thought that there were first different people, pictures, so I guess the order of on my card and on the pictures is a little bit confused. Let's see. Now, the Franks, after they were hiding, I jump ahead now, the Franks were in hiding from July 6th of 1942 till August the 4th of 1944. So that's 2 years and 1 month. They were discovered. It's still not clear who betrayed them. And I've often said it really doesn't matter who did it because so many people were betrayed. There were 25,000 Jews in hiding in the Netherlands. And of the 25,000, 10,000 were discovered. They were not always betrayed, but they betrayed themselves by being careless, by getting too close to the window and not closing the curtains. That was one way that people got caught. Or they had to change address because the family that put them up had a new baby or had a grandmother that moved in and there was no space for them. So they had to go out to another place. And even if the other place was arranged, they still looked very white because they hadn't been outside for a month and they were very nervous, so they betrayed themselves by their behavior. So 10,000 Jews who had been in hiding were discovered and were sent to Westerbork and from Westerbork to the camps in the east, Sobibor and Majdanek and Auschwitz, and Belzec being the most well-known ones. And this picture here shows the people from Westerbork, which was the transit camp, taking their belongings and getting on the trains. So this is not a picture, that's from a book. I don't have a personal picture of that. And here are those terrible trains, with the cattle cars where people were transported from Westerbork to Auschwitz, presumably. The Franks were deported in September of 1944 with the very last train that left Westerbork for the camps in the east. The last train to Auschwitz, there was one more that went to Belzec, but okay, so the second last train, if you want to put it that way. And that was, in a way, a good thing because they had not been as long in the camps as many other people. Every week more that you spent in the camp was a week closer to starvation and to sickness and so on. Hence Otto Frank, who was a very Spartan person, survived, whereas Margot and Anne were shipped from Auschwitz back to Bergen-Belsen, which is in Germany, and Mrs. Frank died in Auschwitz, not in the gas chambers. She died from exhaustion. So that gives a little bit of the story. Since I'm surprising myself with the order of things, I have to improvise. Okay, this should have come first. I'm sorry. This is my non-Jewish grandmother who saved our life. She was a grand lady with her dog, a fox terrier. And here is Mr. Karl Meyer, the person I mentioned a few minutes ago in the middle, just a German soldier. He was part of the occupying German army when the Germans overran the Netherlands. He was in a Air Force communication unit. But as soon as the country was overrun, he was bored stiff, and a lawyer friend of his, he was a lawyer, found this job for him in the headquarters of the German occupants, and he readily took it, knowing that it would give him a possibility to do some good, and that's what he did. Okay, this is the piece of paper in German, of course, which says that my mother, number one there, is not Jewish, and that my sister Susie and I, Hannelore, and my younger sister, whose name was Marion, that's just Maria, were henceforth half Jewish, and therefore the marriage of my father, Edmund Joseph Klein, and my mother was a mixed marriage, and we were more or less safe. So this was a very important piece of paper for us. Okay, speaking of paper, I showed very briefly earlier a picture of Rudy and myself. Rudy was my boyfriend at the time, later my fiancé, and even later my husband of more than 60 years. He had to go into hiding. And when I said you did not want to know anything about anybody that you had no business knowing about, I always knew where he was, always. And I always was his connection to the world. I always provided things for him that he needed, from food to flowers to books, whatever I could do to make his life in hiding more bearable. The top one is his ID with the J, which all Jewish people had to have. And the bottom one is his falsified ID without a J. The Dutch have a very, very good name as book printers. Elsevier is a world famous publishing house. And so much of the Dutch resistance was falsifying papers. They were excellent. So this is his falsified ID. I have to surprise myself. What's next? Because, as I said, okay, let's not do it. Okay. I would have to go pretty far afield, maybe just very briefly. Rudy got very antsy in hiding because to be locked up like Anne and her family were is very hard on a young man of 20, you know, just to be quiet all day long, and when the bell rings, he was upstairs, then you had to freeze in whatever position you were in because the floors were wooden floors, and if you took just one step, the visitor would hear that there's somebody upstairs, but nobody was supposed to be upstairs. Only the housewife, the mother, was supposed to be there. So it was a very, very tricky situation, and at a certain point, he said he could stand it no longer. He was getting stir crazy. And his hiding father was in contact with the Dutch underground. So he managed to get false papers for Rudy, and Rudy tried to escape to Spain. And that was the one that I just nixed, but here it is. This, for those of you who read some German, this is a special piece of paper saying that he had important business to do for the German army, and that he needed to be to get all the help possible to get wherever he wanted to get in France. And he traveled with those papers in a German train, had to say Heil Hitler and pretend that he was a good German, whereas he was fully Jewish, so that was pretty heroic. Anyway, it was to no avail. He came to the Spanish border and couldn't cross the Spanish border and had to come back and had to go back into hiding. But that was just a sideline of this story. I think, yeah. Okay, so far the story of the Frank family and the story of my family, including my husband. Maybe it's a good time for you to ask any questions that you might have, because the second half is totally different. The second half of my presentation has to do with my scholarly work on Frank's diary. I asked Otto Frank in 1977 whether it was all right with him if I would look at the diary from the standpoint of a literary work, and he was delighted, and I got very much involved in Anne's diary as a piece of writing. But that's a different part of the speech, so let's first hear any questions about Anne and her life in hiding. Okay, let's... You have to yell pretty loud, I guess.
curious to know what happened to that community of the Jews who had come from Germany to the Netherlands.
Yes.
After the war? Did they continue to live in Amsterdam? Did they go elsewhere?
Yes and yes and yes.
Okay.
By and large, nobody wanted to go back to Germany. I know of just one prominent writer who went back, and none of us could understand why she did it. Now I can, but at the time, I couldn't understand. Many, particularly of my generation, of Anne's generation, identified with the Dutch and wanted to stay, and eventually became Dutch citizens. Some people, particularly a few that came back from concentration camps and did not feel as welcome as they felt entitled to, set to hell with it and try to leave for overseas. So all three possibilities were given, really. Any other questions? Yes.
No, thanks. Did you know Corrie Ten Boom?
Did I know who?
Corrie Ten Boom.
No, Corrie Ten Boom, I didn't know. I know about Corrie Ten Boom, but I didn't know her personally. No, no, no. She wrote a book also about hiding. Yeah.
How do we know Hans Kallmayr's altruistic motives? I mean, his confirmed gullibility in believing your story.
How do we know that he was really trying to help people?
Yes.
Well, we know, number one, because of the number of cases that he approved of. And if, for instance, in the case of my family, he never asked any questions that could have revealed the opposite. In other words, he didn't probe. He should have, according to the German authorities, but if a request, a petition looked halfway plausible, he gave his stamp of approval.
Thank you.
That was good enough. He did not, he tried, because it would have been too obvious if he had approved them all. I mean, that would have been the end of his job, obviously. So he did not approve all of them. And he tried not to approve the ones where it was not a matter of life and death, where, for instance, a person who was half Jewish claimed, no, he or she was only quarter Jewish. So what? You know, he said, no, it wasn't well proved. No, it was not a good case. Rejected, you know. So he did as much as he could. But few people, yes, where he said no because the petition was not plausible enough and it was too transparent that it was fake. And he just said no, but he tried very hard. Really. Any other question? Yes.
It's a little personal. When you survive something as terrible as all of you did, and as Anne's father especially did, how do you find the strength to go on?
I'm sorry, could somebody help me? I didn't understand.
How do you find the strength to go on with your life when you survive something like this, like what Anne's father survived?
Anne's father, so he came back to Holland.
How did he manage afterwards?
How did he manage afterwards? Okay. Well, that's a part of the story that I really meant to tell and somehow didn't get around to telling. He came back and he knew that his wife had died, but he thought that both Anne and Margot had survived because Bergen-Belsen was not an extermination camp. But it was a terrible camp because there was sickness and starvation and no hygiene, and people died naturally under the circumstances. So there was some hope that they would survive. And the railroad transportation was totally disrupted in Western Europe by the end of the war. So very, very gradually, single trains came from Germany to Holland, and the few survivors straggled back. And so Otto Frank, with a picture of Margot in one hand and a picture of Anne in the other hand, went to the railroad station and asked the people who came straggling out, did you by chance see this girl or this girl, and so on. And he went to the station with my husband, then fiancé, who had the same urgent quest for his mother, who was also in Bergen-Belsen, and who, of whom we knew she had actually survived in Bergen-Belsen. So the two men went together to the station and held up the pictures, only to find out that neither Anne nor Margot nor my mother-in-law would come back. Rudy's mother was among the many, I think 10,000 or so people who did survive, but the British who liberated the camp took pity on those starving inmates and fed them K-rations, which of course the people who were starving could not digest, so people died even faster, which was really very, very tragic. In contrast, by the way, to the Russians who liberated Auschwitz, Auschwitz was mainly evacuated, but there were still a few hundred people left in the infirmary, and the Russians, who knew starvation from Leningrad at the time, knew what to do with starving people. They fed them baby food and nursed them back to life. And so the people who were liberated by the Russians, by and large, fared better than the people who were liberated by the Western Allies, which is quite an irony, isn't it? It's really terrible. But I should have mentioned that, that Otto Frank and Rudy went together to the station because Rudy did not know the Franks. We did, the Kleins did. When Rudy and I got married in October of 1947, Otto Frank was actually Rudy's best man because we had sort of adapted him a little bit as an extra father in the family, and he had adopted us a little bit as no replacement for his kids, but for younger generation vivacity or whatever you want to call it. So he was our best man at the wedding. I thought that picture was here too, but as I said, something went wrong with the pictures. I should have gone over them once more. It is there. It's there. Let's keep going. Maybe. Okay. Something else again. Here we are. Okay, so this the man in the door is Otto Frank, and the couple is Rudy and myself, October 1947. All right. Any other questions? Yes.
I was wondering what your specific path was after the war. What led you to Portland State, and have you been back to Frankfurt since?
I'm sorry, my hearing is
That's
off.
Okay. Why are you now at Portland State? What brought you there, and have you been back to Germany and Frankfurt since?
Well, how did I relate to my past? Yeah. Once the past was the past. All right, the first 10 years after the war, we did not want to talk German. We did not want to go to Germany at all. It remained enemy country for a long time, kind of sometimes even irrationally. Even now, if I were at the Portland International Airport and I would hear people talk Dutch, I would sort of sidle up to them and say, hey, I speak Dutch too. If there were people who talk German, I don't need to talk German, you know. And this is purely emotional, because here I was a German professor, and we have in Portland a very excellent summer institute, a German summer school, where we only talk German, so I can do it very well. But I have to give myself a push, and that's totally emotional and something one better not give into if you can handle it. We came to the United States not as refugees. We came to the United States because my husband, after the war, studied physics, became a nuclear physicist. And this was the time after Sputnik, and nuclear physicists were welcome, heavens. I mean, the same man who was not at all welcome in the late 30s when he really needed to be allowed in the United States, it was very, very hard for refugees from Germany or Austria to be allowed in the United States. You had to have a wealthy sponsor, and if you didn't have a sponsor, there was no way of getting in. But as a physicist, yay. You had a question?
After the concentration camps were liberated, how did those refugees go to be integrated back into European society? I was just curious as to how the different countries welcomed them back, or if the refugees really struggled to find home again.
Officially, of course, these people were residents or citizens of the countries, and they were allowed back. How welcome they were differed from case to case. Their apartments or houses were taken by other people. And restitution was a very slow and painful process. I have heard and read stories of somebody who came back to his former house and saw the gentleman open the door in his father's suit, and yet he was not made welcome at all. That was one extreme. And the others, my mother stored things for everybody in his kids' sister, and we were delighted to see people back and to give them their belongings. So it all depended. There is no one way, and different people have different experiences, really. Any other question? Okay. Okay, I skipped this picture here, the barograph. I was tickled when I was interviewed yesterday by Eurobarometer, because we had a family diary that was called the barograph, which is a barometer that registers what's going on. We started writing the barograph in December of 1943. It was very different from Anne's diary because it was a family diary, which means that everybody read what everybody else wrote. So you did not write, "My sister irritates me terribly." You did write, "I wish that Susie at times would be a little bit more patient, and I maybe should do something about my impatience," something like that, you know. So you soft pedaled, which you better do if you write publicly. But we did this in order to keep up the family morale, and it did quite a bit of good, because you had to reflect on what we were doing with each other, for each other, and against each other. And it has been a quite useful tool for the family. So I still, I typed it out many years later, and my children each have a copy in English translation, because it was not written in English, of course. And so it's sort of a family document, and I thought it would be fun to show it. All right, if you are game, then I will put on my scholarly hat and talk a little bit about the well, oh my goodness, where is the critical edition? You didn't bring it. Oh, here goes my, what the French call pièce de résistance, my big thing. Oh, horse. Okay. What I will try. You have the critical edition? Hey! Could I borrow it? I promise to return it. Wow! Wonderful! Thank you. Okay. So, this is the diary of Anne Frank. Let me explain what most people don't really know. Anne decided in March of 1944, when the family had so repetitiously listened to the BBC, which they always did at night, was forbidden, but we did it anyway. Radio Orange gave Dutch news, and the Dutch Secretary of Education asked for all people in the Netherlands to please save their letters and their diaries, because that would be the basic material to write a history of the occupation on the basis of these preserved papers. And that put a little spark into Anne's mind, and so she decided to rewrite her diary and make a publishable book out of it. Otto Frank never let on to that. When I asked him in 1977 whether it would be all right for me to use the diary as a literary object to study, he said, "By all means do," but he never said, "But be aware of the fact that this is not really it, because Anne had revised her diary. Well, I was quite peeved about that, I must say. Otto Frank died in 1980, and he gave all the papers of Anne to the Dutch Institute for War Documentation. And at that time, there were some neo-Nazis, particularly in Germany, but also in Norway, who started to say, this diary is fake. It was never written by a little girl of 13, 14. Somebody just, you know, made a good story, wanted to sell it and get people to sympathize with the Jews and blah, blah, blah. So Otto Frank had to go to court several times to defend his daughter's diary. And so when he gave all the papers to the Dutch Institute for War Documentation, they looked at all the papers and they found that the diary was really not the diary, but there was a version that Anne had written from her 13th birthday in June of 1942, till they were found and deported. Then there was a revised version that she had started in May of 1944, and she revised 327 pages in just 3.5 months. She must have worked very diligently to do that. And it's a real, real division, a revision to make it a piece of literature. And I'll try to show you some of that if it works. Here's me, priest, the secretary, who picked up the diary after the Franks were found and had to come down from the attic. One of the officers who arrested the Franks emptied Otto Frank's briefcase, thinking there would be valuables in there, and the valuables that came out was Anne's diary. So that's it was scattered all over the floor. And by the way, it was never just a diary, because if somebody writes as frequently as Anne did, then a little booklet is full very soon. So there was a first volume, second volume, third volume. And then there was a rewrite, and it all came tumbling out of Otto Frank's briefcase. Okay, now things get complicated. Let's see whether we can... Does it work? Yay, it works. Okay. Different versions. So this is the diary version C, the way Otto Frank published it. The big outline from June 1942 till August of 1944. All right? This here, diary one, is the first volume of what Anne wrote. Oops. My light is off. Oh, here we go. Oh, can you see diary one? I'm sorry. There. I don't know what I'm doing wrong, but something, it doesn't. Okay, okay. So this is the first part that she wrote. Then the second part went lost. Nobody ever found it. It's gone. And the third part of her original writing starts in December of 1943. So there is a gap of a little more than a year and 2 weeks. This is the second part of the diary. And that was scribbled for, and then the third diary goes all the way to August of 1944. Anne started her rewrite. That's the, here. The B version, starting at the beginning and all the way as far as she got till the family was arrested. She got to March 29th of 1944, and then they were arrested, so she never could rewrite the rest of the diary. But if you have the standard diary somewhere at home, look at it and look at the period between December 42 and December 43, and you will see that it's written quite differently. That's the part where she writes a typical day in hiding, gives those beautiful vignettes about a session at the dentist, all these beautifully well-composed pieces of writing. They are all You will find them all concentrated in this period because there is no A-version existent. What Otto Frank did deplorably is he mixed the A-version and the B-version according to his own best insights, which, although he was a wonderful daddy, did not show any literary insight, really, unfortunately. And so all of you have read, and let's put it, an adulterated version of Anne's diary. And I was very upset about that when I found out, and welcome something which I find a little amusing. It was wrongly said that I am in the diary as Hansi. There's no Hansi in the diary, but there is a long footnote in this edition under my name, under Laureen Nussbaum. So I am in here, but only as a scholar, not as a friend of Anne. So the truth was half spoken, but not entirely spoken. Anyway, I am here. I want to give you a few examples of what happened with the versions. Oops. No, this is the wrong way. What's happening? Oh, I put it upside down. Here we go. Okay. So in this version, critical version, the texts are always one after the other. The A version, the way Anne wrote it originally. The B version, the way she rewrote it. And the C version, what Otto Frank made out of it. I think it's probably too far away for you to see the details, but I try to show that there are omissions where I have this sign. There are additions, this is added by Otto Frank. For instance, when Anne writes, but I cannot confide fully in my father, and he added over everything, which made it a little softer, you know, that's a typical one. And leaves out, and I'll get to that, Peter, Otto Frank puts Peter back again. I don't know whether I can, omission change. Yeah, wherever it says B here, it's based on the B version, wherever it says A, it's on the A version, and you see that Otto Frank mixed the two rather freely, and it was not his right to do that. I mean, it's all right, daddy knows best, okay, but you don't dabble in other people's writing. I think that's an absolute no-no. So I have been trying for years to get the Anne Frank Foundation to publish the B edition, just the B edition. But there is a very bad thing about the B edition. It only goes to March of 1944. So the last 3.5 months, April, May, June, July, 4 months, we wouldn't have if we only published the B version. Then you could go back to the A version. I don't know whether that would be a good idea. But anyway, we have not read the book that Anne wants to publish unless we get the critical edition and only read the B version. That would be what Anne wanted us to read eventually. There's one word. Slide here, okay. That's also rather relevant. On the page before, written on May 19th of 1944, Anne writes that Peter is all good and well, but we don't get anywhere. I think this is the end of our close relationship. And the next day, she starts rewriting her diary. That's kind of remarkable. She just felt, you know, having visits with Peter upstairs was good, but it didn't lead anywhere. She might just as well devote her time to the rewrite. So the next day, she starts rewriting the diary. And what does Otto Frank do? Because he didn't want to let on to the two versions. He, oops, come on. No, that's not what I wanted to do. I'm sorry. Okay, the whole first sentence is left out. It says, well, I can't read it up here. I have to look in the book, I'm sorry. But she says that she's actually starting to rewrite the diary, and Otto Frank did not let on to that. He did not want to be bothered with the two versions. He probably didn't know what to do. I have no idea what his motivation was, because he never talked to me about it, unfortunately, because I knew, of course, what to do. And so, and so no, for him, I was just younger generation. What do the kids know, you know? That's the way it goes. 7, 8, 12, yeah. Okay, so she says, at long last, after a great deal of reflection, I have started in my Achterhaus, which is the name of the book, the back quarters. In my head, it is as good as finished, although it won't go as quickly as all that, really, if it ever comes off at all. So she is really starting to rewrite, and from May the 20th till August the 4th, she has rewritten 327 pages. That's remarkable. Plus keeping up her regular diary, which she did too. And the way she rewrote it, the way she tried to make each entry a little jewel in its own right, is just absolutely remarkable. And I often think that the popularity of Anne Frank is certainly in part due to her excellent writing. She was by no means the only teenager who wrote a diary in hiding. There are several others. I don't know whether anybody here knows the book by Jacob Boas, We Are Witnesses, 5 diaries of teenagers who died in the Holocaust. Anne is one of the 5, and the other 4 are very fine diaries, but they are not literature. Anne's is literature. And so if anybody is interested in reading more than just Anne Frank, because Anne Frank is just one life, and a very important one, but still just one, I can recommend the book by Boas. He lives in Oregon. He's a historian. Another book that I can hardly recommend that is focused on Anne Frank is by Francine Prose, Anne Frank, the book, The Life and the Afterlife. It's an interesting title. And then there is, of course, the book by Willy Lindwe, also in English, The Last 7 Months of Anne Frank, which fill the gap that many people have felt. We only know what happened to Anne in hiding, what happened afterwards. And these are women who were in the concentration camps with Anne and did survive, and they were interviewed after the war. And it's very interesting to hear or read what they have to say. Okay, I think, again, I don't know how long I'm supposed to keep going, but there might be more questions. So ask me questions. No, I dumbfounded everybody. Yeah.
There was a little girl in Sarajevo during the war in Bosnia, who wrote a diary. It was called Zlata's Diary. I don't know if you had a chance to read it.
No,
but that doesn't matter. So this little girl wrote what was happening during the bombing of Sarajevo, blah, blah, blah. And there was so much controversy over this diary, because it became very political, because the Serbs said, she's not
Anna Frank. Oh, you mean the question? Yes, I know. No.
You read that? Could you comment on that? Because I would like to know, for all the children now in the world who are suffering, who might be writing something in Syria, in Sarajevo, in wherever, what happens to that? This has become such a political issue now that you can... So could you comment? Just tell me about it.
Yes. Well, I'm glad that you're bringing this up, because I somehow there's just that many things you can say. But what happened to Anne, unfortunately, has happened again and is still happening in other countries. And if I talk in public, it's always because I've had a feeling that my friends and relatives who were killed in concentration camps yelled out to us who survived, tell the world so it won't happen again. And I did this with great enthusiasm about 30 years ago, but now I have seen it happening again and again in so many places. I still speak out, but with less illusion that it makes a difference. It's up to the younger generation to use it, catch the ball, run with it, and make something out of it. I can only tell at this point. But yes, that's the big tragic thing, that it happened again after World War II. We thought naively this was really the war that would end all wars. People would be wiser, people would learn. We had many illusions. And in my book, they haven't come to much. They have come to naught, quite frankly. So the book, I forget the woman's name, but I know.
Slata.
Yeah. I read her book, and I'm quite aware of it. Yes, okay.
What did you think the first time you read the diary? And what did you think after it became so famous?
What do I think?
What did you think the first time you read the diary? And what did you think after it became so famous?
Okay, the first time I read the diary, of course, in 1947 in Dutch, it had no news about hiding and the situation of the Jews. I knew all this, you know. What I found fascinating is, at that point, that it was written by a person 13 to 15 years old, and how few pieces of literature do we have written by those young people. So that was the only important thing for me at the time. In the meantime, I've seen that it has become a door opener for many, many young people to try to face the Holocaust, and I think that's the importance of it. It's sort of the first step. People who think they have dealt with the Holocaust by reading the diary of Anne Frank, I don't believe that at all.
When you were in Amsterdam, what were the little things that you did with your friends and your family that was kind of like a resistance towards the Nazi power? Maybe not something big, but something just little that you held close towards yourself.
Oh, well, our whole life was focused on surviving. And for instance, I've often been asked, mercifully not today, what did you do for fun? Well, we didn't do much for fun. We had to survive. That was the main task. We knew it was important to be supportive of each other, look out for each other. That was terribly important. We also had a very simplified way of looking at things. A person was either good, which meant helpful, or fault, as we said, was strong if they were Nazis, and there was white and black, good and evil, very neatly separated, which of course turned out after the war wasn't quite as neatly separable. But otherwise, life in Amsterdam went from good to less good, to bad, to worse. We had a winter of 1944-45 when we were literally starving. Our rations were 200 calories a day on which nobody can exist, and people died from starvation. And I've often wondered if the Franks had not been found and not been deported, would we have been able to feed them through the hunger winter? That's a pretty iffy question. I really wouldn't know the answer to that question. It was terrible, the hunger, really. And we had no electricity and no gas. Try to live in the city without electricity and gas. In fact, I was a senior in high school, and my fiancé, who spent his last half year in hiding in our family, rigged up a bicycle so I could generate electricity so I could read for my finals. So you don't ever see me on an exercise bicycle. I've done my share.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
I seem to remember that at one point there were four pages of the diary that came out.
Oh, the missing pages.
Yes. that he had set aside. I wonder if you could touch on that at all.
Okay, well, I could, because it was a very hot subject 15 years ago. It was very, very hot in 1998, to be precise. There were a few pages that were not in the previous critical edition, because Otto Frank had not given them to the Dutch Institute of War Documentation. He had given them to a friend of his, who was the director of the Anne Frank House, Cor Zerk, his name, and Cor felt at a certain point it was time to put these pages with the rest. And the reason why Otto Frank kept these pages, which I again think was not very judicious, because Anne is speculating about her parents' marriage. They let a very astute and peaceful very rich, but Anne observed that her mother was more devoted to her father than her father was to the mother. Although he was a very sweet and caring husband. And she speculated about the fact that Otto had had a great love before and could not marry that woman because of difference in social status, and that he was, his heart had been lost to this first woman, and that he went through all the motions and did everything that he was expected to do, but not with great enthusiasm. And Otto felt, of course, this was really getting into his privacy, and he suppressed these pages, but they are part of Anne's diary. So in 1998, these pages surfaced, and they were included in the critical edition, and we have them now, and it, I think, was not a very wise decision of Otto Frank. He could have made a footnote or something, you know, that Anne was mistaken, but he didn't do that. So that these were the pages. And there were also two pages about a different introduction. Anne had written a, an alternate introduction, yet another version, but not nearly as good as the one that was printed. So these were the missing pages, yes. Any, I'm glad you asked the question. Any other things that I could answer?
I find it interesting that Anne would revise a diary if since it's so personal, and I just wondered what kind of revisions would it would she what was she trying to accomplish with sharing her?
Well, she
her
really
story.
When she rewrote it, she wanted to write a book about how it was to be in hiding, and she used her diary as a basis. And some of the more personal and childish things that she felt were childish, she left out because she felt they were written at the, you know, at the moment when she was angry with her mother or when she was amazed that she was developing breasts or things, things like that. And she didn't think that was important enough, so she would leave them out. But she wanted to write an interesting book of how it is to grow up in hiding under the circumstances that she grew up. And I think it's a very legitimate goal for a writer, and that she wanted to be a writer, there's no doubt about it. I mean, there's so many remarks where she says, I want to be a writer, and when I write, I feel that I'm really myself, and so on. I mean, it's quite evident that she wanted to be. Does that answer your question?
Thank you.
Okay. Anything else? Okay. Not that I have all the answers, I can only try.
I hope not to intrude on your privacy, but I was curious if your own religious feelings were changed by the experience of the war or the knowledge of the Holocaust.
Of course, it formed my whole person. I mean, the experience of the war, when I think back of my life, which is by now way over 80, those 5 years of the war are not just what would it be, 1/16th of my life or 1/17th, they are ye big. I mean, they are so important in my life. They were the formative years and they are very important. And of course, knowing about the Holocaust, yes, that's basic. I mean, to even a ludicrous degree, when I heard, you know, I fell the other day and scraped my both knees, and I think, well, what's that compared to what people had to go through in concentration camp? It's always there and it's always part of my life. Sure.
Thank you.
Sure.
You mentioned earlier that some people think that her diary is fake and it was propaganda
for the Jewish suffering. Yeah.
Yeah. How do you feel about that?
Well, I mean, it's people who have a set opinion will latch onto anything to prove that they are right and the others are wrong. It's terrible. I mean, but it's also ludicrous in a way. So you have to contend with these things in life. You know, nothing is ever easy. That's another war experience. Nothing is easy. You have to fight all the time and use your judgment.
Yeah. Hi, can you tell us An Anne Frank story, maybe something interesting that she said to you one day, or something that happened during a weekend at tea.
No, I'm afraid I didn't know her well enough, except when we did the rehearsals. I did not pay particular attention to Anne Frank. She was just one of the kids, you know, that I knew and that I did things with, and no spectacular story that I could tell. I'm sorry, I have to disappoint you. I don't have any special story, no.
I think it's often overwhelming when we hear about these kinds of tragedies around the world, and especially when we hear about more modern tragedies like this, other genocides. What would you say, especially to young people who get overwhelmed, and we see a lot of Facebook activism, bumper stickers, that sort of thing, but what more meaningful action can we do when we hear these
things? I wish I had an answer. What can we do to stop the genocide? Anybody ready answer for us? No, I don't want to laugh at you, heavens no. I think it's a terribly important question, and I don't quite know how to tackle it, but I do think that one of the reasons that we are so helpless is that we are relatively ill-informed. I don't think our media inform us very well. So we don't know exactly what's going on. Take Ukraine as an example. I think our media are not informing us well. We get a one-sided view of Putin, the horrible guy, and we are so good, you know, and we want to help Ukrainians. I think it's much more complex that people cannot form opinions unless they are well informed. And I think that's a real scandal. I think that's at least something people can try to do, is to get after the media and make sure that we get better information. Then we can maybe stick our heads together and do something. But as long as we are so ill-informed, we are victims of whatever opinion is the prevailing opinion, I'm afraid. Yes.
Why do you think it's important for people today to remember the Holocaust?
Say that again, sorry.
Why do you think it's important for people today to remember the Holocaust?
Why is it important for people to know about the Holocaust? Well, as I said, originally my idea was we need to know, we need to tell, so it won't happen again. It is happening again, but it shouldn't happen, so it should. It should warn us, and it should help us try to devise ways of stopping it. And I'm not the right person to give you a great idea what to do. I've been in many, many, many demonstrations and protests for peace and anti-war and anti-nuclear and what have you. But I don't think it has helped enough. It's better than nothing, but it's not enough. So more people need to speak up, and more people need to be aware, I think. Awareness is the first step. And if I talk here, it's to help you be more aware. That's about all I can say.
Thank you for coming tonight. I'm interested to know what things people you knew did to mitigate what was happening. You mentioned how things shrunk. Jews weren't allowed to go to the park, to go to cultural events. You had to go to a separate Jewish school.
Yeah.
When each of these things happened, did any of the people in Amsterdam protest in small ways, big ways? Did they know it was happening?
They knew it was happening, and they showed their sympathy, but protest, of course, in an occupied country is a very, very dangerous thing, you know, because then you are the enemy of your occupiers and the consequences are harsh. So protest is a lot asked, but we did have a wonderful protest in Amsterdam in February of 1941, where the first Jews were arrested. There was a general strike, and that was a fantastic gesture, but it was broken by force after 2 days. Mm-hmm. And so there was no next strike, you know, but it was a great gesture, really.
Were there any things like, you know, we hear about young women who are not being allowed to go to school today for religious reasons in some Muslim countries. Were there any people who tried, you know, to do something like that to secretly assimilate, you know, maybe not a public protest, but something like what the German gentleman did? Were there other people who did small things, like bringing you food or, you know, other
oh,
things
yes.
like
oh,
that?
Oh, yes.
To help?
There were many helpful people, and there were lots of good political jokes that we whispered to each other to show our disapproval. I mean, the bulk of the Dutch population was definitely anti-Nazi, which was, of course, also anti-occupation. You know, it was much harder to be anti-Nazi in Germany than it was in Holland or Belgium or France, where the Nazis were also the occupiers. But the overriding sentiment was anti. At the time when the Nazis were victorious, they had 5% of the population. So that was all. But still, you know, it means you have to watch out. Every 20th person is a Nazi. I don't know which one, so you have to be careful, right?
So, like, during the Holocaust, there were, like, so many people who stood by and did nothing when they could have. Do you blame them in any little way?
Do I blame, say, the Dutch population for not rising up? It sounds like I should, and I feel in a way I should, yes. But having lived through it, you know, it all comes bit by bit in little steps. And every time there was a new decree, we would say, well, if that's all, we'll live, you know, make the best of it. And so it sort of creeps, sneaks up on you very gradually. And before you know, something terrible happens. But it goes by small increments, and that's devastating, really. That's why people have to be on the watch out all the time, because sometimes the things are just the beginning of big things.
What kind of relationship do you have with the people that survived the Holocaust?
What relationship do I have with what?
What kind of relationship do you have with the people that you knew that survived the Holocaust?
That survived the Holocaust? Yeah. Well, I had a very good friend in Amsterdam. She just died this last year, who came back from Auschwitz. And I felt towards her like many people here feel towards me. I never knew when to bring up the subject and when not, you know, because you don't want to rub it in, but you don't want to be callous, so you are very careful. But once in a while, the subject came up, and we would talk about it. But it was always a very delicate thing. And then a cousin of my husband came back from Theresienstadt, which was not nearly as bad as Auschwitz, but she was really psychologically wrecked by the experience. And we had to be very tactful and very careful with her, because she would never ride a train anymore, for instance. She was ruined in many ways. And so it's a good question, and it was a very delicate subject, really.
Oh, what was the most difficult time for you, like, throughout the Holocaust?
Say that again?
What was the most difficult time for you throughout the whole Holocaust?
Oh, my goodness. I have one very vivid memory, but it's the most difficult one, I cannot tell. But since I was a very strong girl, I always loved to lock things, carry things. And we had friends. My mother was very fond of the lady. And I found out that her neighborhood was going to be emptied of Jews, so I bicycled over and helped them pack the suitcase and locked the suitcase down 3 very steep Amsterdam steps. They were very steep, the steps in Holland. Houses are narrow and high. And I remember giving them their suitcase. They were lining up with all people with a star. Of course, I wasn't wearing a star anymore at that point. And bidding them goodbye and smiling my polite girl smile and feeling it was a grimace. And that grimace is still with me. It was an awful moment, because I had a very strong sense I will not see them again. What am I helping them with? I'm helping them with to go to the concentration camp. What an awful thing to do. I was totally, totally confused, and still am. So many things have no answers, you know. But I remember that moment. I must have been 15 or so. It was awful. Just to help somebody be deported. Should I not have helped them? They would have been deported anyway. At least I did something friendly for them, you know. It was an awful, awful moment. So that's the answer I have right now, okay?
I've got one last one.
Okay.
Did you know anyone who was in the underground resistance groups?
Of course I knew people in the underground, yes. Oh, yes. Otherwise, we wouldn't have survived. Well, Rudy, my husband, was in touch with the underground, and got help from them. And of course, I knew quite a number of people who hit Jewish people. Rudy went to at least through 4 addresses, and I knew all of his helpers. And they knew again other helpers. Yes, I knew people in the underground, but not many of them, because we didn't want to know many, but I knew a few. Yes.
Let's set Laureen with our thanks and appreciation.